I'm sure it's no mystery that longevity is a multi-billion dollar industry, and it tends to feed on the fears of people of getting disease or of not living as long as they imagined. Our genes are not our destiny. Many people think that they have a fatalistic attitude and think that, oh, it runs in my family, or there's nothing I can do. I disagree. I have congee every morning for breakfast, an ancient porridge made of slow-cooked and tapped kernel grain. How about a berry cashew cheesecake without the moo in it? Most chronic diseases are the long-term result of what we eat and how we live. And they're largely preventable. A healthy diet and lifestyle, even if you adopt it later in life, even if you adopt it after the onset of a disease, like the men who had prostate cancer in my study, it may help to prevent, to slow, arrest, or reverse many diseases. I would also point out that many of us have one or another predisposition to develop some condition later in life. And these predispositions may have to do with, you know, genetic inheritance, something we were exposed to prior, earlier physical or emotional trauma. We all accumulate these dings, these issues, as we go through life. But while they may make us more susceptible, they don't often guarantee that we will have full-blown disease just because you have a susceptibility. There needs to be a cofactor. That predisposition can be likened to a seed, but the water still needs to be poured on it to grow a disease. And that water, I would submit, comes in the form of a poor diet and an unhealthy lifestyle. And sometimes, if we deprive the disease, even after it started to grow, of additional water, it'll stop growing and it may even dry up. So the potential for healing, I would think, exists even at a late stage. It's not a guarantee, but there's nothing to lose. Now, another important key to health and longevity, I think, is to think about health span rather than lifespan. I'm sure it's no mystery that longevity is a multi-billion dollar industry, and it tends to feed on the fears of people of getting disease or of not living as long as they imagined. But instead of fixating on diseases or how long we'll live, I think that our focus should be on living healthfully and happily. Some years ago, 1987, a pair of gerontologists, Rowe and Kahn, coined the term health span, and they proposed that we should aim to maintain wellness for as long as possible and as close to the end of life as possible. And they said that if we do this, we're more likely to remain disease and disability free, to have a great quality of life, and to increase our lifespan as a byproduct. One of our final goals, and I kind of learned this a bit from my dad and others, one of our final goals should be to compress morbidity. We're all going to die of something eventually. Maybe we'll be a natural death, but most people have something. But our hope is that that disease only occupies a very short time and toward the very end of life, and that we live well and healthfully up until the last possible moment. And when our time comes, the goal is to experience a peaceful death on our own terms. Now, one last thing I want to share, and that is, what constitutes a healthy diet? Because that's a really key, important cornerstone, I think, of healthful aging, and something that I've been immersed in my work. I think a healthy diet has five core principles, call them the five pillars of a healthy diet. It should be based on whole, not refined or processed food. It should be mostly plant-based. Again, doesn't require being a strict vegan or vegetarian, but most of our diet is plant food. It should be locally grown. It should be in season. And now, these aren't perfect things. Sometimes it's hard to find locally sourced things, but as much as possible. And it should be balanced, not just nutritionally balanced, but also aesthetically balanced, a variety of colors and tastes and textures and cooking methods that are involved in our food. Also, we want our primary food groups, plant-based, to emphasize these: whole intact kernel, whole grains and vegetables. Grains have been much maligned because they're confused with gluten, which they don't necessarily connect with. Some do, but many don't. Or because they're confused with white flour products. Whole grains are the opposite end of the spectrum, and they're quite nourishing. Vegetables, a wide variety with an emphasis on dark green and leafy green vegetables, which are excellent for heart health and cancer. Beans and legumes, fruit, seeds, nuts. Secondary food groups, healthy animal foods. So if you're eating food of animal origin, aim for cold water, wild, small fish, for pasture-raised poultry, and so forth, not for commercial feedlot, things that are pumped with hormones or things that will get into us. We also want to have certain primordial foods, things like seaweed and mushrooms. These have all kinds. Seaweed, for example, contains every mineral required by the human body because it's bathing in ocean water, and we evolved out of the ocean, and our biochemistry links to the mineral balance of the oceans. So seaweed is a wonderful food for that purpose. We want to have fermented foods, not so much probiotic supplements, but probiotic foods that are going to give us a diverse array of microbes to help diversify our gut microbiome, to inoculate it with these things. And the other plant foods provide the vermisht, the nourishment for microbes. And this is the way to grow a healthy, diverse microbiome. We want to also have green and herbal teas. And so you may be putting this all together and saying, well, okay, brilliant, cold porridge and stale bread again. But actually, it doesn't have to be this way. A whole food plant-based cuisine is diverse and beautiful, appealing to the eyes, to the palate, very satisfying. And here are just a few examples of things that we teach and teach how to cook in some of our cooking classes. Congee, which is an ancient porridge made of slow-cooked intact kernel grain. I have congee every morning for breakfast. Kidney bean stew. Curried vegetable medley. A side of a seaweed wakame salad. How about a berry cashew cheesecake without the moo in it? And one of my favorites, greens a la Caldwell, dedicated to Caldwell Esselstyn, the surgeon from the Cleveland Clinic I mentioned, because he emphasizes every day his heart disease patients having servings of dark leafy greens, lightly cooked. We teach a lot of these things in our program. This is a shameless plug in our program in integrative nutrition through UCSD Extension. That's my colleague, Lorraine McElhern. She and I co-run this program. If anybody's interested for more info, here's some of our contact info for the Centers for Integrative Health, for the Krupp Center for Integrative Research, named after Dick Krupp, who endowed us with a major gift, Ms. Leslie Sebastian, who's actually here today, and yours truly. Anyway, thank you very much. Appreciate your attention.